Okay, you ready?
Yep.
All right. Hi, my name is Norman Loeb from NASA Langley Research Center, and my presentation follows nicely from what Lazarus talked about. He was talking about the effect of clouds on radiation budget. So mine will be more general about radiation budget in general. So this diagram you might have seen quite a few times in various presentations, but this is the energy budget, how it looks. So solar radiation, 340 watts per square meter, so about 3.5 hundred watt light bulbs for every square meter. So lots of energy from the sun. Roughly half of that energy is absorbed at the surface, and this is really what fuels our climate system. A third or so is reflected. And then in the atmosphere, it's reflected by clouds, molecules, tiny particles, aerosols. And then some of it is absorbed as well. The Ceres instrument, the clouds in the Earth's radiant energy system, is measuring the top of atmosphere as well as the outgoing long wave. So anything that has a temperature emits thermal infrared radiation. And so what you see here is we have about 240 watts outgoing long wave radiation. And so if the system were perfect equilibrium, then there'd be as much absorbed as there is emitted. And it turns out, because we're adding various greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, we're in a state of imbalance. There's about 0.7 watt imbalance. So that's a residual of fairly large terms. And I'll talk a little bit more about this quantity because it's really important for climate. So in the infrared, you have, if we didn't have gases like water vapor, greenhouse gases like water vapor, CO2, the planet would be about 33 degrees colder. But we've got these water vapor greenhouse gases, which essentially absorbed thermal infrared radiation and then radiated back downwards. So it's keeping us warm, livable temperatures. So that's really kind of important. And as we change the composition of the atmosphere, we're adding more greenhouse gases. And so we're causing this imbalance through these various greenhouse gases. So how do I switch? I just go ahead and switch. So this is during the Ceres period. I talked about that imbalance, about the incoming minus outgoing. And this is how much of the energy, the heat uptake, we've observed during the Ceres period. We launched in December 1999 on the Terra satellite. And so if you just look at the cumulative amount of energy that this planet has taken up, you're seeing that we're increasing. So we're adding more and more energy to the system. So where does that energy go? We're adding more energy, so it's got to go somewhere, right? Does anyone have any ideas where that, or all this extra energy that's entering the system? It's going into the ocean. So the next slide shows you where that energy is going. So about 93% of that heat uptake by the planet ends up in the ocean. There's only about 1% that's actually being used to warm the atmosphere. 3% is used to warm land, and another 3% for melting snow and ice. So that's pretty remarkable. So all this extra energy is in the ocean. And that's really important because we're not realizing the full impact of this extra energy yet. So it's kind of like a bathtub. When you take a bath in the evening, you open the door and you get out. Well, the air cools pretty quickly because it can't hold heat, but the bath can, the bath water can, and that's the same thing that's going on. So essentially that's warming in the pipeline that's in the ocean. That energy that's stored eventually will realize that. The system as a whole will warm as it goes to equilibrium. And there's about an extra 0.6 of a degree warming in the pipeline from what we've added so far into the oceans. We've already warmed about 1 degree, just above 1 degree since pre-industrial. So even if we didn't do anything, we should see some additional warming. Of course, we are continuing to change the composition of the atmosphere, so we expect to see even more warming. Next slide. So this is looking more directly at the observations, the Ceres observations of what we're actually getting from the satellite instrument. This is the reflected solar and the emitted thermal, and I think Lazarus described this very nicely. So the white areas here are higher reflectivity. The blue areas are where you're getting more energy that gets absorbed into the system. And in the thermal infrared, you're seeing these orange-red areas where you're it's essentially hotter areas that are emitting more. So that's where the cooling of the planet is really coming from. It's this thermal infrared. And the white areas here are the clouds. So the clouds are higher, so they're emitting from colder temperature. So there's less outgoing long-wave radiation from those clouds. And you could see that these clouds, these tall clouds, are emitting even colder than in polar regions up here, where you're getting a lot of blue areas. So that's where the energy is leaving the planet. So the next slide. So this is a kind of a different perspective. Now, if you take the satellite instruments that we have, for example, Terra, Aqua, SUMI MPP, these are all in what's known as a sun-synchronous orbit. They just sort of orbit and cross the equator at the same local time. But then what you can do is you can take those instruments together with geostationary instruments, which are essentially fixed. There's five geostationaries at any one time around the globe, and they're essentially following fixed points on the Earth. And so they're sampling at a very high rate. So this is how the radiation is changing. This is the net radiation, that how it's changing every hour. And you can see there's a lot, there's a lot of variations going on as a function of space. And if you didn't have clouds, this would be like, that red would be like a big bullseye. And so you see that the clouds here are really changing. This is the infrared part, nighttime, and then you have the sun coming in with daytime, and all of these crazy patterns showing up because of the clouds. And this is really tricky because climate models have to be able to replicate these types of patterns. And that's one of the big challenges of climate modeling, is be able to represent the clouds in all of their full complexity in terms of their spatial distribution and their height distribution. So that's really the big sort of impediment to being able to predict how the planet will warm after we double CO2. And that's a big, big area of research right now. So the next slide. And this is, Lazarus really covered a lot of this already, so I won't go into much detail. He showed pretty much how the clouds impact the radiative fluxes at the top of atmosphere, at the surface, and within the atmosphere. So I'll just point out that, we have to be able to replicate these types of patterns in the atmosphere. If you're warming the atmosphere, you're going to change circulation, because you're warming, you have warm and cold areas, well, something responds, and that's the circulation in vertical. And the challenge, again, is because there's so much energy that's reflected and emitted from the system, and these clouds are sort of have this pattern of change, understanding how clouds change over time is really what we need to get a handle on, because it's essentially a feedback. As we force the system, we warm it. Things like water vapor will change, which we understand pretty well, because if we heat the system, the air can hold more water vapor, and we can model that very accurately. But when we change the temperature by adding CO2, et cetera, the clouds are much more complicated. We don't fully understand. Are we going to see fewer low clouds? And you could see if we did see less, fewer low clouds, we're going to have essentially more energy coming into the system, which is going to exacerbate, it's going to cause even further warming. Are we going to have more low clouds? Well, that would offset the warming. So those are the kinds of questions we have to be able to answer in terms of how the clouds are impacting climate of the future. The next slide. So this is a pattern. I'm getting away from sort of the climate and more into the technical issues now. So the satellite instrument that we have, the Ceres instrument, what we're doing is we're orbiting the Earth, And we're measuring radiances, which is essentially how much energy is coming from a given direction in either the reflected solar or emitted thermal. And the thing is what we really want is the integral over all angles. And so this instrument has a unique feature where it can rotate an azimuth. So typically a satellite, as it orbits, it just goes like that, goes in cross-track mode. But we can actually program it on the ground, send up commands, to have it do all kinds of different types of scanning. So we can have it rotate an azimuth as it scans in elevation. And so then we can measure the radiation from different geometries. So that's what's basically what this is showing. And what we're able to see is that different types of targets on the Earth have different signatures. And so we use that capability to be able to represent that dependency, that angle dependency, which enables us to get more accurate measurements. So this is sort of a technical sort of feature that we have on this instrument that's quite interesting. Next slide. So this is showing what's changed. So this is looking at trends, how these quantities of radiation have changed since the beginning of the Ceres period. So this is running from March 2000 to January 2017. And you can see these patterns are quite complex. So a lot of these are essentially cloud changes, primarily. And a lot of these changes are very closely tied to things like El Niño, La Niña over that Ceres period. But there's an exception. There's one thing that's really stood out over this record that's really sort of hits you in the eye is what's going on in the Arctic. And there was a question earlier about the Arctic. So you can see this red area means that we're increasing the amount of energy coming into the polar regions. And that is really robust. And does anybody know why that's happening? Is any ideas? It's over the sea ice, right? So we're reducing how much sea ice is happening. So we're allowing more energy to come in because sea ice is fairly reflective. And if we melt more over time, then we're going to absorb more because the open ocean doesn't reflect very effectively. So the next slide shows this very nicely. So here we're looking on the right is the sea ice fraction change. So this is the changes in absorbed solar radiation on the left and changes in sea ice fraction, in this case from 2000 to 2014. Just looking from 70 to 90 north over the ocean. And you can see the patterns are very similar. So there's a lot of loss of sea ice in these regions. That's very nicely correlated with the changes in absorbed solar radiation. So the summertime is really when you're melting that sea ice, June, July, August. And primarily that's what you're getting here. So one of the other things we're learning from this data set is there are clouds as well as sea ice. And we're not seeing the clouds having much impact on the trends in the absorbed solar radiation. They cause fluctuations, but this decline is really driven by the sea ice, which is a bit of a surprise because we weren't sure, as you got more open water, whether the clouds somehow would adjust to offset the changes in sea ice and cause more reflected solar radiation. But we're not seeing that. We're seeing that how much energy is absorbed is in lockstep with the changes in sea ice, which is sort of a pretty interesting result. I think that's it, right? Okay, so that's all I have. Are there any questions?